Rebecca Smith of the University of Tennessee has agreed to shift to right before the break with her presentation on native brook trout reintroductions. Do a source's population genetics influence reintroduction success?
All right, so thank you again. My name is Rebecca Smith, and I'm a third year graduate student at the University of Tennessee in the Ecology and Evolutionary Bio program. I'm in Dr. Ben Fitzpatrick's lab, where we research population genetics. So today I will share with you some of my population genetic findings with the Southern Appalachian brook trout. So brook trout are the only native trout in the region and in Southern Appalachia in the park. So therefore they have a lot of interest from the public and management for the conservation of the species. Now, while they were once widely distributed throughout the region, they have now been extirpated from roughly 75% of their historical habitat. And part of the reason for this is due to overlogging, but it's also because of the competition with the introduced trout species that are in the park, which are rainbow and brown trout. And now current brook trout populations are fragmented throughout the park. They're small and they're isolated from one another. So because of this habitat loss and the need for conservation, the park has implemented a reintroduction program. And what they do is translocate wild fish in the park, so wild populations, not hatchery stocked, and then they release those into streams where they want to restore the historical habitat. Currently, there are 13 restored brook trout streams, and we actually have plans to restore an additional 6 more this summer. So what does a brook trout restoration project look like, or a reintroduction? So first, they have to remove any of those non-native trout from the restored site, and then translocate individual brook trout from one site to another, from a source stream to the restoration site. And that's what I'm doing here in this picture. I actually have brook trout in that container on my back, and I'm packing them out from one site, and we were putting them into another site within the park. However, there are some problems that arise within the reintroduction program, which the first problem is that natural populations, they're too small to remove large numbers of individuals. So management must mix multiple sources in a single reintroduction site. There are some positive and negative outcomes of mixing populations though. So again, those brook trout populations, they've been isolated from each other for over 200 years. And this genetic isolation could genetically separate the population and create more variation between the populations. So this brings up two caveats. The first is that mixing multiple sources could be good, create a bigger population with lots of variation. However, it could actually have an opposite effect. So if those populations are too genetically different, then offspring from those matings could lead to an outbreeding depression where the offspring actually have a decreased fitness. And caveat number two is if we only use fish from one source, then we risk a genetic bottleneck, which is a decrease in genetic variation that could end up leading to an inbreeding depression, which also has decreased offspring with decreased fitness. But population genetics can offer some insight into these issues and help with the source choice. So that brings me to my overarching research question, which is, do brook trout from different sources have different effects on the persistence and evolution of reintroduced populations? So today I'll demonstrate how population genetics can address with that fundamental issue of reintroduction biology of source choice. And we have brook trout samples from restoration sites in the park that have been collected for over 20 years. And with those samples, we can measure the ancestry of fish in the current restored sites. And then we can also look at the genetic admixture in the restoration sites to see if the fish from different sources are mixing with each other, and we can measure that over time. So here's the park map, or a map of the park. And I'm currently collecting data from 6 of the 13 restoration sites. Those restoration sites are the pink diamonds. And then again, we have to use multiple sources in each restoration site. So those source streams are shown in the green. Today, I'm going to focus on one restoration site, which is LeConte Creek that I've got circled here. And its sources used to stock LeConte Creek were Indian Camp Creek, Cosby, and Greenbrier. And then I also want to point out, I have the three major watersheds highlighted. That's the Little Tennessee in blue, the Little River in gray, and then the French Broad in red. And just to note that management always tries to keep the restoration and source sites within the same watershed. Okay, so LeConte Creek was actually one of the first brook trout restoration parks in the project within the park. So here they took 100 fish from each of those source streams, Indian Camp, Greenbrier, and Cosby, and they mixed them together in LeConte Creek. And since that initial reintroduction in 1999, no more fish have been added. So they let those 300 fish mix together and repopulate that LeConte Creek site. Tissue samples have been taken from the fish in LeConte Creek post-stocking in 2006, 2010, and just in 2022 last summer. So again, this gives us a perfect opportunity to study admixture and ancestry over time. Before I get into my results of the ancestry in LeConte Creek, I just want to break down how we're going to read these genetic and ancestry plots. So each bar represents one individual, each of these vertical bars, and they have unique genetic segments from each source population, and those get color-coded. So in LeConte Creek, we have three source populations. And if fish are mating randomly, I'll keep coming back to random mating, but if fish are mating randomly, then they should have a mixture of the ancestry source. So if the individual has an even measure of ancestry, we would see something like this vertical bar where one third of its genome is coming from the green source, one third of its genome is coming from the purple source, and one third of its genome is coming from the orange source. However, if fish are not mating randomly, so they have a preference for their mate choice, maybe it's a preference for what source that source the fish came from, then we would see an individual with less evenness, so a smaller evenness, maybe something like 0.1 that I'm demonstrating here, where 90% of its ancestry is coming from the orange source and only 10% is coming from the green source, and then there's no representation in this individual from the purple source. So if we put that all together, we have a full ancestry plot. And we can imagine that our initial starting conditions in LeConte Creek look something like this, where each of these vertical bars is a single individual. And altogether, we have 100 from green Cosby, 100 from Greenbrier, and 100 from Indian Camp. Now we would say this population as a whole is even. We have even representation, but each individual is not evenly mixed as they only have ancestry from one source. Now we would also imagine that if there was that preferential mating, this is what the population would look like even after the several years of mixture. But if there's been random mating, no preference for mate choice, then we did expect the population to give us ancestries of results similar to this, where we see each vertical bar has a mixture of all three sources used to stock LeConte Creek. So there was a publication in 2008 where the researchers wanted to look at just this. They wanted to see what percentage or what amount each source was represented in LeConte Creek 7 years after stocking it. They ran a parentage analysis, but we believe that they violated the assumptions of that model. So I used their same data set, their methods, and repeated their analysis multiple times, and I was never able to come up with the same results they were. So I believe that they came to some premature conclusions of assortative mating. And I'm not sure that that outcome that they reported was could have been a result by random chance. So here I'm offering a different approach and a new insight to determining the ancestry in LeConte Creek. So to do that, I set up a genetic ancestry analysis instead of the parentage analysis. And first I parameterized a null model of random mating to make predictions of the population in LeConte Creek, what they would look like if the fish have been randomly mating. And then I'm able to compare those expected results to the observed data from those tissue collections in 2006, 2010, and 2022. And we did this with a microsatellite panel of 11 variable loci. Again, here's the initial starting conditions, 100 fish from each source. And now here is the actual ancestry results from the sample taken in 2006. So here we have 50 fish that were sampled, and 24 of the 50, so nearly half, have ancestry proportions from all three sources, Kazi, Greenbrier, and Indian Camp. Now I've got 2006 here on the top, and I'm comparing that to the sample taken in 2010, which was 90 individuals. And from almost 50% to 87% of the sample in 2010 had ancestry proportions from all three sources again. And now I've got 2010 here on the top and the sample taken in 2002, where we sampled 60 individuals. And we've gone from that 87% here to 94% of our samples had ancestry from all three sources. So again, before I can draw any final conclusions, I want to compare these ancestry results to that null hypothesis or the hypothesis of random mating to see what the expectations of LeConte Creek should look like. So I'm going to compare my observed to the expected. And one way to do that or to test random mating is to simulate random mating. So in this plot on the x-axis, I've got that population evenness. And that, remember, is how evenly distributed are the sources within the population of LeConte Creek. So when we first started, we had an evenness of 1 because each population is equally represented. But on the y-axis, that's our mean individual evenness. That's that single bar, which accounts for the proportion of ancestry from each source in the individual. And again, at the time of introduction or in 1999, each fish had an evenness of 0 because they were all from one source. And then my dashed line in the middle is that 1-to-1 relationship between population evenness and individual evenness. So we start here at 1999, at this point. Again, population have an evenness of 1, but each individual had an evenness of 0. And we expect over time that the population should move closer to that 1-to-1 relationship if we've got random mating. So that's what I've done here. I've got simulations. I'm showing you these are my actual simulations of random mating. These are my expectations. And I have 1,000 simulations for each timestamp. So each dot is one simulation. And in purple, I have 1,000 dots. That's 1,000 simulations. To give me an expected distribution of the population evenness in 2006. And then in yellow, I have another 1,000 distributions or 1,000 dots to give me the expected evenness distribution in 2010. And the same for the dots in green, that is the expected evenness distribution for the fish population in 2022. So if our observed samples of the population in LeConte Creek fall within those expected distributions, we would assume random mating there. And in fact, they do. So here, this red dot, that is our observed evenness sample from 2006, and it falls within our 2006 expected distribution. That dot right there is our 2010 observed sample from LeConte Creek, and it falls within the expected distribution. And again, we see that in 2022. With that observed sample falling within our expected distribution. So now I feel that I can reliably conclude that our observed data of LeConte Creek fall within these expected distributions of random mating. And we can see that there doesn't seem to be any preferential or sortative mating in LeConte Creek. So some final conclusions are, we failed to reject our null model of random mating. So we do find random mating in LeConte Creek. And because of that, we had an even ancestry mixture. We had an even representation of the sources. So there is no bias of one source over the other in LeConte Creek, no signs of assorted mating. And lastly, our results disagree with that previous publication. And so what does this mean for management? Well, I guess for future research, we're going to continue this analysis to those other restoration sites and see if we can find the same trend. And importantly, it also helps support claims that brook trout populations within the park are not different species. They are not reproductively isolated when we mix them back together. And so that's all I've got for you guys today. I just want to thank, several people actually. Matt Kulp and Caleb Abertson have been just amazing to work with in the Park Service, the fish crew, and their many technicians that have helped collect all the fin clips for DNA analysis. And then at USGS, Dave Kazyak and Barb Lubinski have provided the older data sets as well as stored all the fin clips that have been taken over the years. And they've also been excellent to work with. And then here at UT, my advisor, Ben Fitzpatrick, who spent endless hours talking and guiding me through this analysis, my lab group and committee for providing valuable feedback, and then Dr. Staten and on the ag campus and her bioinformatics lab that have helped run the simulation for this analysis.
Sure, I'll chime in. I know with your reanalyzing some old data, microsatellite-based data, and sorry if I missed it. I know you all and Ben's lab do a lot with genomic data. Where is that going now, and how, or do you think that will kind of refine or change understanding of brook trout populations going forward?
Thank you for that question. So we are currently getting data analyzed with genomics and doing RAD-seq to develop some SNPs. We don't have that ready yet, but that will allow us to go even further to detect selection in the reintroduction sites. We also are working with some brook trout researchers at Michigan State who are developing a thermotolerance panel with SNPs and RAD-seq, and they've used samples within the Great Smoky Mountains as well. So they're actually developing that thermotolerance panel for brook trout throughout their entire native range in the eastern United States. And so we'll be able to work with them and look at thermotolerance, especially for those restoration sites that are at the lower elevations. Most of our source sites are at about 4,000 to 5,000 feet. So they're a little bit cooler and they have more shade up there. And so the restoration sites that are lower may not have more shade. They might be a little bit warmer, so we can look at selection and thermal tolerance with that genomic data. So stay tuned.
Great. Sounds very interesting. Look forward to it. Thanks.